I was looking over the paper that's in the Dropbox on Psycho, supposedly by me, to shorten it and take out some things to emphasize as a talk. And we learned a lesson I learned before, which is very important whenever you write a paper and you have files, when you finally finish it, to label one of the files final version. So the thing that was in the Dropbox that you guys stuck with starts out the way the final version does, but then it's just some draft version. It wasn't the final version. I'm very sorry about that. It must have been completely unintelligible because it was part of a lecture sequence where the previous lectures haven't been heard by you. I apologize. But I will provide Elizabeth with a final version if anyone wants to read it. It exists. I'm sorry about that. So I don't quite know how hard it was to read, but it looked like a mess towards the end toward me. Anyhow, I originally was going to give a paper kind of on more general issues about philosophy and film. That longer paper is in the Dropbox and hopefully is a more final version of that material. But then when Elizabeth showed us the schedule, I saw Robert was doing a first paper on Hitchcock, and I thought for purposes of thematic continuity and having one discussion build and the other rather than completely changing the subject and doing something else, I'd do something on Hitchcock too, so we could just build on that discussion. And my thought that might be a good idea has already clearly proven to me that, it's already clear to me that's true for reasons that will become clear. And so also, rather than just read the paper, I think I'll pull some things out of it that will also connect with some of the issues that have already come up in the discussion. So here's two things I thought I would highlight that are going on in this paper. One is, I think this was contained in a number of the questions, what counts as an interesting reading of a film? On this way, I'm reading film that I think for all of our maybe differences in detail, Robert and I share. And here's just one criterion. It's not the only way things you can do with films. You can treat them as symptoms of, late capitalist society, all sorts of other things. But here's a thing that would count as an interesting reading of the film, that the reading of the film allows you to notice lots of things you didn't notice. I mean, I think that's what good art criticism does in general. It's a good art critic of a painting or a poem allows you to see the thing and notice all sorts of things and start to schematize it and get into focus for certain kinds of art, certain kinds of painting. There's a sense in which you don't see it at all, so you know how to see it first. And I think that's what a good reading of the film does. So I think one measure of the fertility of a reading of the film was just how much it discloses of the film. So the whole thing reorganizes itself. So you start experiencing differently, noticing things differently, appreciating why it's put together the way it is, and having that much more to say about it. So the reading just continues to build. So a further measure of a good reading of the film is not only does it show a lot that you didn't see before, but it opens up questions and ways of looking that further show things. And I think, this is one measure of a great work of art. It's sort of not clear where this stops. So a really good reading of a really good film, not only does it do this for a great deal of time, but you don't feel like you're done, which is why a theory that just says this is what the film's about, da-da-da-da, I'm done, itself, a film that just illustrates a theory like that, or any work of art that just didactically, as it were, is a bit of data to prove a theory, I think is ipso facto not a great work of art. A great work of art is precisely something that, it's no accident, I think, there were so many essays about Vertigo, or Hamlet, for that matter. It's not just because they're so damn badly written, no one can figure out whether this interpretation or that interpretation is right. Rather, we're saying about the very structure of the work that calls for multiple interpretation and exploring the thing through the interpretations that prove to be revealing about it. So that's one thought, and so I'm going to try to make that a little bit. I think Hitchcock is a director who, if you're interested in this way of approaching film, is a director who leaves lots of things for you to uncover that then opens up a space which opens up questions and things to think about beyond anything he himself could have thought to the bottom. So that's one measure of not only a great work of art, but a certain kind of great film. So, by the way, maybe it's worth saying, an aside, why I think the model of data and theory understood a certain kind of way, therefore, is also not a good model here. At least, in what Thomas Kuhn calls a normal phase of scientific activity, the data need to have some independence from the theory. Here's the data. We agree with the experiments shown. Which theory explains this better? Or alternatively, here's the experiment. We agree with what the experiment shows. Therefore, we should reject the theory. Whereas, I don't think all of science is actually quite that simple. When you get really interesting revolutionary scientific theories, it causes you to understand the data differently, or to ask questions differently, or to see a certain experiment is no longer very important, which was previously thought to be important. But in the normal model of data and theory, the very point of data as a control in theory is also to be interpretable independently, to some degree, of at least the theories that are supposed to bear on that data. Whereas that's precisely not what I was talking about here. What I was talking about here is ways of looking at the film that open up the thing that we're calling data in the first place. Maybe I'll take a really trivial example that occurred to me, which will be worth coming back to, from Vertigo. Here's an example, which is, it's a moment in Vertigo I don't think Robert talked about in detail, but it's just before Judy runs up, I'm assuming everyone's at least watched Vertigo for this session, runs up the tower. I'm sorry, she's not called Judy at this point, she's called Madeline. Kim Novak runs up the tower. She says, there's one thing I must still do, and she's saying things like, as he's kissing her, no, it's not supposed to happen this way. And if you watch that scene closely, what will you notice, it's a little hard to even know how to describe this now, is that Kim Novak, shall we call her, is not managing to sustain her sort of upper crust Madeline voice, and she's sounding more like the Kim Novak out of earlier movies like Picnic, you know, a character from Salina, Kansas. We haven't met Judy yet. We don't know. She's from Salina, Kansas. And so instead of speaking in this sort of more upper crust voice, suddenly there's this other voice saying, it's not supposed to happen this way. This very American Midwestern voice seems to be cracking through. Now, you probably don't notice that on the first view, because you're quite absorbed. But if you do notice it, then all it is for you is something like bad acting. You know, Kim Novak is not managing to sustain the accent of the character she's playing, Madeline. It's not data in the relevant sense. Once you've seen the movie only a second time, you can see that as a much more layered performance than you did before. You see Judy playing the part of Madeline, and now that she's someone who's also falling in love with Scotty as he's falling in love with her. But it is too late. We're too late. Isn't now just about the Carlotta story and how she's doomed to die, but it's the fact that Elster is standing up there with a dead woman who he's going to supposed to throw off the tower, and she's part of a murder plot, and she doesn't know how to explain to this man who she's now falling in love with, who's in love with her. Oh, yeah, I love you, but I'm part of a murder plot, and this is what's been going on the whole time. So it's too late. Too late has a different meaning. The person who's saying too late is not just Madeline, but it's Judy who's also trying not to not be Madeline, because then she's giving away the thing she's trying not to give away. So now this becomes data. But this becomes data only in the light of a further understanding of what's going on in the movie, which you only have in a second viewing. I haven't really talked about interesting reading it. This is reading at a very thin level. You know. But it's still seeing what's going on at this moment in the movie, at least in the light of a full moving viewing of a movie once and coming back to it a second time, and now having data that you couldn't have had before. Now, what a good interpretation, a reading of film will do, will keep further disclosing such data. But its very status as significant data, does this change in accent? Does this movement of the camera, does this have significance or not? Is something that it acquires through our understanding of the movie and the reading that we have. It's not just a bunch of facts that sit there, you know, in a kind of in the physical medium. The other paper of mine, which we're not talking about, which is background, if anyone read it, is about the concept of the meaning of the movie and why it's not a physical medium. Part of what I talk about there very briefly is the difference between a documentary and a movie and how those are different media, how they can consist of similar stuff in this sense. So understanding what it is that we're reading is something we do through the activity of a certain sort of viewing. It's something we do as second nature, to some extent, if we watch a lot of movies. So one of the things I think could be a task for film theory, which some film theory does, it's the film theory that interests me most in film theory departments, is bringing to reflective consciousness all of the forms of second nature we have in interpreting the significance of moments in movie in ways that we don't realize that we do because of the incredibly complicated narrative forms and forms of cinematic ontology that have become second nature to us. That a certain kind of cutting significance signifies certain kind of temporal, or causal, or romantic, or point of view, or all kinds of other relations or significance. So that's what I mean by a good reading. I'll try to bring that up in a moment with a very simple line example. And then another topic that came up in discussion with Robert, especially towards the end, and I thought I would try to sort of highlight this issue a little bit when I said today to keep the continuity of discussion, is, you know, what does it mean? It can seem, I think, foolish to some people to claim that a Hollywood movie is a great work of art. So I'd like to sort of give that idea some weight. But there's many ways you could do that. I don't think this is the only way, but here's one mark. Not the only mark, or even a necessary mark, but a fairly traditional mark of a great work of art, which is the sense that once you have spent some time trying to understand it and work with it and cover its significance, you come to have an appreciation of how extraordinarily perfectly it's put together. And, you know, one way of sort of trying to capture this intuition of extraordinarily perfectly put together would be if you try to make even the slightest change, it would come into view as a flaw, the way the smallest flaw in a diamond is visible as a flaw in a gem. You know, try changing a single word in a Shakespeare sonnet. And if you really appreciate that sonnet and why it works the way it does, that note will jar. It will in a very well-written symphony, or it's a feature of a work of art that all of its parts are connected to the whole, and the whole conditions the way we experience in the parts. You can just sort of like switch one out. So, and I do think Hitchcock, in that sense, for all of the other ways in which he's a rather modernist director, has a very traditional conception of great art, and is trying to bring that conception of great art to the cinema. He is trying to construct works that he has an extraordinary control over. And if we come to appreciate him, we'll sense that control. And so I do think it's very important, you know, that the person who signs the credits and so forth don't have the last word about what goes into it. Or this would not be Hitchcock movie. It simply would not be the kind of thing we're talking about. Now that's consistent with all kinds of people having come up with ideas for how to do things and his liking them. It's not that he is authored each moment, but that the thing holds together in a certain kind of way is, I think, important, the kind of ambition it has. Now, that also means that there's something right about that, that, you know, something that seems self-evident about Hollywood movies is going to be an obstacle to seeing them in this way, which is the way in which they can also, at the same time, seem to be popular media, you know, that are supposed to at least succeed in the box office. So it is an interesting fact that most of the movies that now are on the top of the poll, Robert, we're talking about, tend to be movies by even successful commercial directors that weren't that commercially successful. Hitchcock went through Vertigo for 25 years after it was a commercial flop. And now it's voted, you know, the greatest movie of all time, at least for 1 year. But still, it was made within a mechanism, within an apparatus, as they say, one of whose ambitions was to produce works that at least could seem to have the possibility of at least initially satisfying a certain kind of popular appetite. And so that means, I think, one thing that's true, and I think it's true of a lot of a great American arts. There's an interesting concept of America in the background here too, but I will focus simply on Hollywood, is that it subverts the distinction between lowbrow and highbrow, or popular art and high art, as that is traditionally conceived. And I think this is another feature of Hitchcock, that he's making things that subvert this distinction. But it subverted it in a very particular way, and this is particularly clear in Hitchcock's movies, but I think they're characteristic of a certain strain of great Hollywood movie throughout certain westerns, noirs, romantic comedies. Namely, that they subvert it from within by initially seeming to respect the terms of distinction. That is, they present themselves as something that is mere tin, that is simply a certain kind of commercial work, that has a certain kind of bottom, something where we think we know what the depth and the shape of the thing is. And then it's only as we start to think about it that we start to realize if this thing is just about its plot, but conversely, at that point you've also been involved in much more than just its plot. in finding interest and significance in it. So the way I put this in the paper, rather simple-mindedly, is that a great Mollywood movie has a false bottom. It's part of how we initially understand it. It looks like we can see what its bottom and what its shape and what its initial terms of intelligibility is. It presents so that we think we, as it were, know what the topology of that space is roughly. And that's not to say there aren't uninteresting Hollywood movies whose only bottom is their false bottom. But I don't, you know, that is to say, that's the only bottom they have. But that is to say, those aren't the ones I think that tend to get remembered and written over and over again. So on a first viewing of such a movie, you can, there's a sense in which you have to take yourself to be consuming a mere piece of entertainment, if you will. At least something that fits squarely into a certain kind of genre. The conditions of intelligibility contains even the least interesting members of that genre. It's participating in something that has that kind of extension. But in order to understand that same movie on a more careful viewing, you also have to come to see how the movie exploits your willingness to underestimate it for its own purposes, to its own end. So the place it's going goes through your, as it were, willingness to think you can see to the bottom. And I think that's very much a feature of Hitchcock's art. Notice, I said on a first viewing and another viewing, this happened when Robert was talking about Vertigo over and over ago. He said, on a first viewing of this scene, what we take is going on between Scotty and Madeline is. Then it's, he said, on a second viewing, we blah, blah, blah. I don't think that's just complicated, you know, terminology, which is easily avoided. I think you cannot talk about a Hitchcock movie. I think this is true for other interesting Hollywood works. Unless you talk about that way, and this is another reason why there's no simple data. There isn't anything which is just describing the scene. There's describing the scene on a first viewing, where you're still kind of working within the horizon of expectations and what you can understand about the movie up to that point. Then there is having seen the whole movie. And in light of an understanding of the whole, coming to think about what the significance of each part is. And in the case of Hitchcock's movies, as we'll see in a moment, there's also things you just simply notice that you didn't notice before. You know, even at the level of plot and presence on the screen, once you've had a first viewing. And so that's part of what you see in a second viewing. And once you see all of that, you understand the plot and the whole and what it is you're interpreting differently. And once you understand all of that at the end of a second viewing, when you go into a third viewing, you're in a position to notice things you didn't notice before. And it's not clear with some of these films, Vertigo I think is the extreme case, what the smallest number of viewings is you even need to before you can talk about having described and understood a scene. But the descriptions are going to be layered in that way. They're going to be these nasty Chinese boxes of significance. I think that's a crucial thing. So what I would resist, to go to the previous discussion, is a view of a movie like this that simply does not permit us that kind of description. Because then I think we miss the fun. Hitchcock himself said, anyone who has ever seen any of my movies only once has never seen it. And that I think is actually, literally true for reasons I'll try to bring up. But it's also a feature of film viewing and receiving culture that film critics will often go to a movie once. The fundamental form of the film review looks like this. And then they will say something about why it's a good and not bad movie based on that single viewing. Somebody who was a Shakespeare critic who said certain things about Shakespeare and said, well, I've only read the film play once, or I've only seen it once, so I'm not sure about that, would be laughed out of the room. Would think that one's in a position to say anything interesting about Shakespeare, unless you'd gone over it several times and thought about what you first saw in the middle and the light at the end. But strangely, the way we receive and talk about movies mostly almost involves the idea there's something wrong with the movie if you can't notice this until several viewings. But I think in the case of a Hitchcock film, it's obvious if you spend any time with these objects that that is the literal truth about how they're made. I'll try to bring this up. So they are, in this sense, classic examples of structures of art, of which I think American art involves a particularly large number of these for reasons that are worth exploring. Huckleberry Finn, Moby Dick, pick your favorite example. but then especially Hollywood, structures of art that contain such a false bottom. Something that can appear to be a story about a little boy, or about a whale, or film noir, initially. But then what else is it? And then on a second viewing, we begin to become unable to miss in Hitchcock movie much that we found it not only easy, but almost impossible not to miss on the first viewing. So we discover double meanings. I'll show you some places where this happens. In the structure of what we take the genre to be, and therefore what can happen or allowed to happen in the character of the dialogue, in just what we notice on the screen. I give you a simple example of what we notice about dialogue and attach significance to, including inflection of voice and accent. And this means not only that you haven't seen a Hitchcock movie if you haven't watched it several times, but it means that to discuss such a movie in any depth, even the descriptions of what there is to see have to be indexed to which viewing it is, in the light of which understandings, relative to how many viewings, what it is you're discussing can even come into view. I'm using view not just for the visual metaphor, but for understanding what's happening in the world of the movie generally. Now, I'm going to use Psycho rather than Vertigo as my example. Not because I think it's a deeper film, but I think the sense in which it contains such moments is perhaps most obvious. So it's most trivially true, Psycho, the things I'm about to say. This has to do also with, I think, it's being a fairly late moment, even later than Vertigo and Hitchcock's oeuvre. And so certain features of the genre of the Hitchcock film have become more and more, as it were, reticulated, more and more daring in involving these sorts of structure. So it contains really countless moments, maybe almost every moment, which, if we're able to look out for it and trust that moment as having depth in its structure, already on a first viewing could warn us that this movie is not what we're inclined to think it is. So if you've seen a number of Hitchcock films and you watch Psycho, even though you might not understand what's going on, you can sort of sense that there's a surface you're not penetrating. If you haven't, then you won't even sense that the bottom is false, even if you don't know how or where to punch through it. And on a second and a third viewing, even without any very elaborate reading of the movie, of the sort that Robert just gave, these movies will already begin to acquire a significance that we come to have attached to them on a first viewing. In particular, on a first viewing of a film, we work with a certain understanding of it as entertainment, as a member of a genre, as having dialogue that has a certain kind of surface of intelligibility within the interaction of the actors, as having opening credits that are only supposed to do what opening credits do, and so forth. Psycho is another film in which the opening credits actually turn out to be very interesting in ways you only notice after you've seen the film a few times. And that can't be coincidence. So first, let's take the case of genre. It's a feature of Hitchcock's films, most of them, that they start out seeming like they belong to a familiar genre. And when he's making Hollywood films, Hollywood genre. People who were watching these films at this period had seen, you don't need film noir to have been theorized as a genre. For people who saw lots of film noir films before the French came up with that concept, to think that they knew certain things about how this movie is going to work in the light of other movies, similarly for Westerns. Once you have a body of such films, you can theorize it, but they already acquired a kind of intelligibility in light of each other. It's, by the way, true, I think, of every tragedy, comedy, Shakespearean drama, and so forth, that consuming members of a genre itself allows you to understand something about the horizons and intelligibility of each one. What kind of thing counts as the kind of intelligibility it has, what you can expect, what the significance of this is. When the sheriff rounds up all the guns in a Western, it creates a certain kind of frisson. When the railway comes all the way and connects the isolated West to civilization, that shifts the genre in a certain kind of way. These features of how the genre work is within the movies. You don't need a French theorist for it already to have those little changes introduce that kind of significance into the horizon of what else can now happen in the movie and what it means. So what is the genre of film noir? We could say a lot of things about that. I thought I'd just quote a little bit of Pippin from the beginning of his book. Articulating a genre, by the way, I think itself is a fascinatingly philosophical topic. I spent a few sentences early on in this essay sort of saying what the Western is, just to give an example of this. And as I try to do it, one starts with concepts like horses, guns, the Wild West, and so forth. But as one tries to articulate the features of the genre more accurately, to bring in the different things one falls in it, one winds one saying something like, you know, a place where civilization itself or civil society has to be refounded. That's what the West is. So it doesn't have to happen in a literal geographical place. What the guns stand for is a certain kind of violence, both as a threat to that and as a condition of maintaining that order. And so it doesn't have to be guns. And so to describe the features of a genre as you think harder about how it works, one finds oneself in a thematic field in which philosophical questions are also being thematized by interesting genre films about what price is acceptable for civil society and what sorts of violence are justifiable and so forth, and what the place of the Western hero who's essential to the creation of such society is once it's founded. Why does he always ride off into the night at the end and so forth? So here's some things that Pippin quickly says about the film noir. Kind of excerpting wildly, only timepiece work, thank you. He says, noirs were almost always about crime, even more surprising the larger social context for such deeds, the historical American world in which they take place, was itself just as bleak, amoral, and ugly as the individual deeds and characters themselves. The so-called American dream in these films comes to be treated with increasingly bitter irony, because in the reality that we see in these movies, what we see over and over again is that it seems that all that matters to success is wealth and power. The noir also gives a certain representation of bourgeois domestic life, portrayed in such a way that it seems so stultifying and banal that even crime begins to look attractive to those trapped in it. The most powerful and effective human passions, suddenly again, this late stage of civilization, come to be again greed, revenge, lust, and craven fear. Characters who had, up to a point in their lives, been righteous, stable, and paragons of responsibility all their adult lives within their social setting are seamlessly and then quite believably transformed through something that happens usually early in the plot of a noir in a few seconds into reckless, dangerous, even murderous types, usually people who suddenly find themselves on the run. All suggesting that anyone, in the right or wrong circumstances, was capable of almost anything, that one's own sincere avowals of one's own basic principles would therefore reveal oneself to be ludicrously deceived. One said, I would never steal, I would never murder, whatever. So that's just a little, a few sentences from a much longer description Robert gives of some generic features of film noirs. And all I want out of quoting them is if you've watched Psycho, I'm hoping you have, and you watch the beginning of it, it trivially seems to fall into this kind of genre. You know, this is not a description of romantic comedy or a Western or various other Hollywood genres. It seems to be this one. So on the first viewing of the movie, Psycho seems to be about a crime, and everything's going to revolve around the crime. And the crime is Marion Crane's theft of the money from one of her boss's clients. And the central interest of this film would appear to be something that participates in these horizons of intelligibly expectation that come from this genre, of which people have seen many instances by the time they go to Psycho in 1960, in which what is at issue is the ever-ramifying consequences of this act, the crime of stealing the money. The larger social context of Marion's crime, the historical American world in which the action takes place in that phoenix of that movie, appears to be at least as bleak and amoral as her deed herself. It's not like we sympathize with the other people in her office. I think those are the good guys. Her impulsive crime notwithstanding, that is, she continues to strike us, which is typical of a certain kind of positive central figure in her noir, at least at first, within that world, as by far the most attractive character anywhere in sight. She continues to have our sympathy and our identification. And no small part of the reason why her initial theft of a considerable sum of money is so laughably easy for her to perpetrate is partly because she's regarded by everyone else in her social world as nothing other than a paragon of decency, stability, and responsibility. Her boss keeps trying to explain to people why Marion could not have possibly stolen the money, which is also typical of a certain kind of early noir twist in certain noirs. That is, in a matter of a few moments, through a single reckless act, she is transformed right before her eyes from a reliable office worker into a criminal on the run who is now terrified at the mere sight of a policeman. That's, for instance, when she wakes up in her car and there's a policeman looking through the window. So this is all just, as it were, the horizon of expectations a viewer who's consumed many noirs brings to his understanding of what's going on in Psycho when they first start watching this film. This all belongs to what I'm calling the false bottom of the movie. This turns out not to be what this movie is really about at all. But this movie also, early on, does everything to lead us to think that we are in such a movie. I could go on about that for a long time, but let's move past that. So all I want for right now, and I think this is even true of a contemporary viewer who isn't as well versed in noirs, and whose movie literacy, if they aren't a student of film history, is cluttered by all sorts of other things. In watching this movie, it still has certain kinds of expectations about how it's supposed to work. And taking or understand everything that goes into what would be involved in a full description of our, as it were, implicitly tacit, schematizing this as something that is participating in the generic conventions, which we may not have brought to reflective consciousness, but which have shaped our viewing of many other movies, in taking it up this way, we take ourselves to know something about how the movie is supposed to work. What can happen, what matters, what the data are, what is salient and what we attend to, and therefore what we don't attend to. What more or less awaits us and what we need to have an eye for. And I think it's almost impossible to count the sheer number of misapprehensions that, in making this a tacit assumption, we fall under all at once. And these misapprehensions we fall into is part of what Hitchcock is preparing. It's part of how the movie works. It's part of what it is that we then experience in a second and third viewing as we fully punch out that false bottom. So one aspect of the false bottom, this is really only one aspect of the genre, but I'm picking one, is that it's created by the inviting and then gradual defeating of generic expectations. That's one of the myriad ways in which, as I put it to begin with, films such as this invite you to underestimate them so that they can then use that for their own purposes. A far more local but equally characteristic device, which Hitchcock makes devastating use of, and Psycho is an extreme case of this, is just at the level of the dialogue, false bottoms of the dialogue. You have the dialogue between two characters. They're talking about something, and it's perfectly intelligible in its own terms. There's no need to go beyond it. But then once you've seen the movie again, you're watching the movie again, this is even true, I think, a good romantic comedy, and you have the right kind of ear to listen, suddenly you discover the dialogue is just laced with double meanings. Now, if it was just in one place, one could argue about it. What I'm talking about interesting reading is once you have the ear for it, you notice line after line after line. Has a second meaning. And in the case of a Hitchcock film, in a case like Vertigo, second meaning understates things drastically. I think you will actually be able to draw, I mean, just taking a line and talking about how it opens up a different layer of meaning as we go through a second and third viewing is itself an enormous amount of work in a film such as Psycho. So, a line is delivered, which on a first viewing movie we don't really think about, we effortlessly take ourselves to understand. That works at the level of what I'm calling the false bottom. On a second, or depending upon how practiced you are at this, some further subsequent viewing of that same movie, you suddenly hear the undertow, or the second meaning of the line. If it's Hitchcock, one of the things you're probably hearing, in many of them, is an undertow of irony, where we'd have to think about what irony means here. Sometimes that line actually winds up meaning the opposite of what it seems to be. Now, that irony, or that second or third meaning, which only becomes fully audible to us once we realize how the world of this movie, the world that's depicted in this movie on a full understanding, is very different from what we thought the world of the movie was, as it were, the first halfway through. Usually in Hitchcock movies, at some point, it's most clear in Vertigo, once we hear her confession, as it were, she's trying to write the note, we suddenly realize we don't have time to do this, you know, because things are happening which we have to pay attention to rethink a great deal that we've just seen. This happens in several places in Psycho, but the first and obvious one is the shower sequence, when we suddenly lose who we think is supposed to be the center of consciousness in this movie. That doesn't happen in a film war. Now, in many Hollywood movies, the way this works is that we first understand the line in a very literal way. And then, you know, once we've understood the movie better, we see that it has a figurative or a metaphorical reading, which is much more interesting. That's true of some lines in Psycho. But it's more typical of Hitchcock, and Psycho is an extreme case of this, where he actually reverses this feature of how the process works in the ordinary interest in Hollywood movies. So what happens is we have an all too familiar turn of speech, which actually contains, in a certain kind of way, a metaphor or a dead metaphor. And we just assume that the way to understand this is, in that sense, in a figurative literature. That's how we understand it. But suddenly, once we see the movie for a second time, we understand that that turn of phrase admits of a far more interesting or alarming literal understanding, a way we don't usually understand that phrase. A reading that, once we discover it upon some further viewing of the movie, stops us in our tracks. So the task of understanding a line of dialogue in Psycho is often one of matter of construing a particular idiom or turn of phrase or speech in a far more literal fashion than you would have ever imagined possible. As if you were coming to understand what that particular set of words really, literally means for the first time in your life. There are many, many examples of this in Psycho. I'll just pick one, because I have other things to do. Norman says at one point in dialogue, "Mother is not quite herself today." And when he first says that, we think we know what she means. She's kind of grumpy, she's angry, she screams, apologizing for her. Once we've come to see the whole movie and come to see it more than once, that's an example of a line, actually every line uttered before and after, which comes to seem to be literally true in a way in which now has an application for the literal truth of that line that you might not have even been able to imagine before. That's what it means. His mother is going around doing things, indeed killing people, but she's not quite herself anymore. One of the next things he says in that dialogue is, Marion raises the topic of private traps. And Norman nods and says, "Yes, private traps. None of us can ever get out. We scratch and claw, but only at the air, only at each other. And for all of it, we never budge an inch." And when we first hear this, we think it's a very metaphorical description of what it is to be stuck in the bourgeois kind of life. That this is a good description of what Pippin is talking about in his book that all film noirs are about. It's a kind of metaphorical description of that. But those lines take on increasingly literal possibilities of interpretation as we fully understand who is speaking and what their relation is to the possibility of being someone or doing something, the sense in which they are trapped. And as Robert was saying, how many different people we have in Vertigo, which we need here too, is this: there is Norman as we first understand him, hotel keeper with a boring life. There is Norman as we understand him, impersonating his mother. There's Norman trying to cover up the fact that he's doing that. There is, as we may come to appreciate, a sense in which this is about Norman's mother, because she won the battle. There is Norman's mother, qua corpse in the ground, that can literally not budge an inch, that is stuck in that trap. So what it takes to bring her back to light the lights and keep up the formalities. Another line, he says, is what he does in his life. Takes on a difference, and so on. Stop there. I could keep moving through the dialogue. But the point is, these levels of reading, you can't see them on a first viewing. That's not data that's just there, apart from understanding the parts in the light of the whole, and different understandings of the end through different experiences, the parts organized through those different understandings of the whole. So all of this is connected with something I said about one mark of a great work of art, namely the way in which it seems to unfold within itself, as I put it, an infinite degree of intention. More than any human being could possibly have intended to place into an artifact crafted by human hands. So that every aspect of the work appears to contribute in an essential way to its overall unity and meaning. If we're talking about a great poem, I take this as maybe the simplest and most banal example of a certain kind of perfection of craft and art. What that would mean is that this poem consists in the idea that this thought can be expressed in this in no other way. That's what the poem is. That the words be just in this order, each one occurring precisely where and how it does, with just these possibilities of alluding to or withholding what is not explicitly or otherwise unsaid, with just these assonances and dissonances, with just this rhyme and meter, with just this length of line, or duration of rhyme, or lyricism, or degree of pathos, or refusal, or restraint, and so forth. Take a lot of work to describe how all of this changes as you change a word in a particular poem. Let that just be a gesture of that. And then let us ask the question whether one could make sense of cinematic poetry in this sense, that a movie aspires to that level of unity, to use a very traditional, old-fashioned word for describing this dimension of art. So if we're talking about a certain kind of great Hollywood film that initially has a false bottom and apparent flat, that would mean, and I will take this to the shower sequence now, the most famous sequence in this movie, every murmur or scream we hear in that scene, or we are unable to hear, every violin stroke of the soundtrack, every camera angle and movement, everything that's shown or withheld from view, the brevity or length of the duration of every shot or pan, not only the number of cuts in the montage sequence, but the dimension and rhythm and pacing of the sequence. Everything that belongs to this aspect of the work carries a kind of aesthetic significance that criticism can reveal why it is so and should be just so for this scene to have the significance that it does, and that it contributes essentially to the power and meaning of the whole. If the soundtrack were allowed to the viewer to hear a bit more or a bit less, or to hear it differently, or if things were shot so we could see a bit more or see a bit less, or visually presented just in a different manner from a different perspective, an alteration of any such seemingly tiny aspect of how things were presented would mutilate the whole, not just of that scene, but the entire movie and how that scene works in it. No less drastically if you tried to change a single word in a Shakespeare song. That's what I'm trying to convince you of in 10 minutes about this scene, and then we can talk about it. So I think there are not many moments in the history of cinema that can fully measure up to that standard of aesthetic perfection. It's an insane ideal to bring to cinema for all kinds of reasons, having to do with the complexity of what goes into it and the collaborativeness of the people that work on the movie. But there are some, and I do think this is an ideal with which Hitchcock worked. And I think the shower sequence is an interesting case to take such an example, because on the one hand, it is arguably, people have who were asked to pick the most famous moment in the history of cinema. I chose this because I noticed this is one they chose. Often was mentioned, whatever they think they mean by that. But then what they say about it, they never comment on any of the things I'm about to comment on. That is, the way in which it carries significance has to do with elements of integration that you can't notice if you pick it out separately from the whole and just try to find its significance as a closed sequence, or a fragment, might be a better way to put it. Let's go to the shower sequence. And I'm gonna argue that, now I need some version of paper I don't have, given you. I'm gonna argue that the shower sequence, what is wrong with you, does five things at once, has to do five things at once for the movie not to fall apart. And part of what I want you to notice is how incredibly difficult it is to make a 90-second sequence that accomplishes all five of these things at once without you, on a first viewing, noticing it's doing any of these things. First thing it has to do is that it has to abstract from the physical horror of the murder scene. What I mean by that, I'll explain, but this is something it has to do. A second thing it has to do is allow for, mediate, a transition of narrative perspective, and indeed literal understanding of what the point of view of the camera is. Because it no longer can be Marin's point of view, because she's dead. So it has to allow us to do this in a way that keeps us absorbed in the movie. The third thing it has to do is conceal the identity of the murderer. So we just think it's the mother on a first viewing. The fourth thing it has to do is it has to dilate the temporality of the scene in order to give us the possibility of processing, digesting, working through the absolutely staggering implications of what's happening here. And it needs to dilate the temporality of the scene while making it seem like what it's a scene of is something that's immediate, violent, and sudden, and in such a way that this dilation does not undercut our narrative and visual absorption in the movie. It doesn't kick us out. One reason people said you can't kill the heroine in the middle of a movie, Hitch, is because people will, as it were, get off. They won't keep watching. Fifth, and this is the one that's connected with the feature of the movie I bothered to set up the most, but it requires these other four for it to happen. It needs to explode our understanding that we are within the horizons of the genre that has been organized our viewing of the film up to now, in such a way that we can still continue to watch the movie while trying to understand what kind of movie it is we're watching, if it's not what we thought it was. It has to do all five of those things simultaneously, without our noticing. How it does it. My claim is, now try changing the montage, or the camera. And you'll say, oh, it does that, but you'll see yourself losing one of those. Let me make out how it does these things very quickly, and then I'm not showing the scene, but we can do that in discussion if we want, because I'm running out of time. So with respect to abstracting from the heart, notice two things very quickly. Two absences. We never see, although we're watching a very violent murder scene, which is a great deal of stabbing, we never see a blade pierce skin. Moreover, it's a little hard to explain what this means, but I think there's a truth in the fire mark. No nudity is ever on display. A simple way of putting that point is he gets this by the censors. There isn't anything on the code for what you're allowed to show, which gives us a sexually erotic shot, even though we're watching a scene of a naked woman being killed in a shower. And some people say the reason you have the montage there and so forth is because he's trying to get it by the censors, and so he needs to serve that purpose. That's not wrong. It's a bit like saying the reason Shakespeare has this word in line two is because it's going to have to rhyme with this word in line four. Well, that's right about the Shakespeare poem. But if that's all you can say about that word in line two, it's not a Shakespeare sonnet. It's a very bad little rhyme. So this is true of the Hitchcock scene. But if you think that's all there is to say about why it's shot that way, then you're missing, among other things, the five purposes that I was just suggesting it fulfills. Another way to bring this out is to consider for a moment the book that the movie is based on, the novel. In that novel, the so-called shower scene takes one sentence, basically. Norman Bates kills Marion with a single well-placed blow of the knife. That's it. Here, in order to kill Marion, the knife has to be raised and driven towards her flesh, seemingly uncountable number of times. Why must that be the case, we could ask. When we watch the scene, we can watch it during discussion if we need to, but I'm hoping many of you know it well. I have it on the computer, though, if we need it. The first thing to notice is, if you shot this scene sort of in a way that such scenes were later shot, you know, shall we say, in the mode of depiction of the chainsaw, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, then it would have been difficult to avoid a fairly graphic and stomach-turning depiction of tremendous violence and carnage. And given what has been allowed so far on the screen in Hollywood cinema, I think any way of shooting a scene that was more conventional, involved a more stable camera, less montage, a more deal angle, would have completely changed the entire movie, even if Hitchcock had gotten it through, and the significance of the scene and how we would have processed it, where we would have been and how we would have been able to move on from that scene. So the details of the horror and the brutality of the scene unfolding before your eyes has to take place largely in your imagination. And this is a further touchstone of Hitchcock's art. If you go back and look at the films, you'll be amazed to see how much of the horror is happening here, not here. For what we are directly given to see, though it conveys a forceful understanding of the form of the death, is one that's brutal and horrible, entirely abstracts, as I put it, from the sensible matter that it will allow us to immediately visually or immediately orally apprehend it as horrible in that kind of way. That is a further characteristic of Hitchcock's art, to terrify us all the more by placing us in this perfectly measured degree of indirection in our relation to that which terrifies us, or holds us in suspense, or fills us with horror, thereby allowing to take hold of our imagination in a way in which any direct glimpse of anything never could. This is connected to the topic of fantasy, as Robert was discussing in Vertigo. If I had time, I would develop that. So he avoids turning our stomach by, as we might call, aestheticizing the horror, abstracting from the representation of the totality of the scene, and fleeting instead from one detail to the next. We see, you know, little body parts. We see diluted blood going down the drain and the water and so forth. So we come away with a vivid impression of violence, brutality, and despair, while seeing relatively little in the way of blood, guts, gore, or sexually arousing nudity. We do not see her injuries. We do not see blood pulsating from the wounds. And there's much more we could say about what we don't see. This forceful conveying an impression of violence, brutality, and despair, in the absence of a focal depiction of physical trauma, allows a maximum of shock to be communicated via intellectual and emotional registers. Allows us a certain understanding of what's happening in what I call the world of the movie, while provoking relatively minimal physical revulsion and visual recoil from the details of what is happening, of what we're actually permitted to see. So it's very important how the scene works, that we don't want to look away from it, because it needs to serve these other purposes. This gap between what we see of and what we understand to be happening in the world of the movie is the space in which the real action, I think, unfolds in Hitchcock movies, which is one reason the data can keep changing. Because we understand what we're supposed to be imagining shifts dramatically as we go through a second and third viewing. And it's precisely for this reason that most of what matters to our understanding of that world cannot come into view if we try to reduce it to a description of what we could describe that's just on the screen, apart from having seen and tried to understand the movie. In the case of Hitchcock's movies, several times. So that's one thing it accomplishes. Another thing I said it must accomplish is a transition in the default point of view. We have to, by the end, be identifying with Norman, not Mary. She is about to die and leave the world. And the shock we undergo is not because merely the central character in that world is dying in horrific fashion, because the subjectivity that has mediated our access to that world is also lapsing in a way it's not supposed to in the history of Hollywood cinema up to this point. That what's threatened also is what we might call the ontological death of the world of the movie. That has to be mediated. How this works, we can discuss, but I claim that without this kind of montage, and the way the montage allows us gradually to shift the sense of the point of view, as well as the way it's prepared and moved off of by the motion of the camera, all allows us to start identifying and be fascinated by what Norman thinks and is doing, and to leave Marion, even though we're shocked that we're losing her. The very way in which it's shot has to give the new significance to the character of what a point of view shot is. And there is this moment in the montage where we're not able to locate our point of view. And we're looking to, as it were, refocus it. And we don't get that until we also realize she is dead. Really dead. She's not coming back. And there's things about the way that's shot that also makes that very clear at the end of it. Now, we really have to distinguish carefully between the first and the second viewing of the film to talk about the other thing it does, which is conceal the identity of the murderer. We think it's the mother. Lots of things has prepared us. So we're not conscious of the extent to which the camera is actually not giving us a good view of her physique, because we don't feel we're missing it, because we know who it is. But I also want to say that the beauty about Hitchcock is that he doesn't cheat. Many people that pretend to be imitating him do not do the thing I call not cheating. And what I mean by not cheating is that on a second viewing, you have no trouble noticing that that mother is much taller than Marion, much too straight, the knife is coming much hot, much too high. The only person we've seen in this entire movie who's that tall and thin is Norman Bates, and this is Norman Bates dressed as the mother. This is Anthony Perkins in this scene. It's very obvious once we know to look at it, but we don't notice it. Just like we don't notice Judy of Selena, Kansas talking in the first viewing. And then we wonder how we missed it. And we see a character who is negotiating between two different roles. We actually see that in many places in the first half of Psycho, once we look for it, as Judy Madeline comes increasingly under psychological pressure in her role. So that's what I mean by not cheating. It's not that Hitchcock just screens things in a certain way, so as film critics say, we make an assumption. We really do make an assumption. The assumption is not forced. It's controlled by lots of things I was talking about. But in a second viewing, we also wonder, how the hell did I miss that? We see how much we failed to see. The data comes into view. In these kinds of cases, we could argue, was the data there or not before? But we can't see that data as data. But in a second viewing, we can't miss it. And that is a significant feature, how these films work. So what I mean by not, what do we mean to cheat now? To cheat would be to present an intentionally misleading scene in such a way that a second or a third or even a tenth viewing, I think here of The Usual Suspects, even when the viewer knows how the film turns out, you're going to be no less drawn to schematize the scene in the manner in which you originally did. Whereas in Hitchcock, once you understand the whole, you can no longer see it the way you did in the first way. What you discover is your pervasive blindness. A reading of a Hitchcock film that does not reveal to us our pervasive blindness on first and second viewings, I hold to be a poor reader. So I'm giving a stronger answer than Robert did to certain ways of looking at these movies. There's much more one could say about how this is concealed and how the use of the camera works here. But Hitchcock also has done many things to rationalize this, so we don't feel like he's withholding us. Where should we put the camera to get a better view? So it's very important that it's happening in the bathroom, it's constrained, it's in a shower, he lets us see the shower head, he lets us look for above. The apparently better perspectives don't seem to be any good. So he's also done much to rationalize this spatially and narratively as well as cinematically. Just like that wild light we get in that scene of the kiss that Robert spent so much time in has been also rationalized through the neon lights, through the character of the drapery in the hotel. So it's both serving enormous emotional and figurative significance, but it's not just arbitrarily there. The scene is when we have to be able to linger over and absorb. We have to appreciate the extraordinary implications of what's happening. If you watch this scene, you realize it takes longer than the thing we understand to be happening takes. But that's not how we experience it. And that's part of what the montage also allows to happen. So we have a sense through the montage and hear the soundtrack and the way it's cut and the rhythm of sound and cutting and the movement of the knife and how they all work together is something we can spend quite a bit of time on. But it is an enormous symphony orchestra with each of these things being the instruments that are working together. Give us a sense of violence and brutality and instantaneity and a sense of the structure of what's happening. While what we see is extremely spread out in time. Extremely spread out means 90 seconds. But 90 seconds is a lot more than one or two. And we need 90 seconds for some of these other purposes to be accomplished in the way that I was explaining. Finally, I won't spend any more time on this, but we can. I've set it up. We need to understand, and this is one of the things we need to process, that the genre we're in has just been exploded, and start to understand how it's been exploded. We could talk about how that happens through this scene, and the kinds of questions we start asking when the scene is over. Hitchcock gives us the newspaper with the money to look at and various other things. Does the money still matter? Various other questions come up. The camera guides us in doing this. But this is all about our, as it were, trying to figure out which of our generic expectations still bear weight or significance, and which things have the structure of what Hitchcock calls a MacGuffin, another characteristic feature of his art, which to fully spell out, I think, would take some work. There's little definitions of it on Wikipedia. But I think understanding what a MacGuffin is properly isn't something we can understand apart from the structure of these false bottoms. MacGuffin always gets its significance through these false expectations that we have. And its explosion is part of our understanding of what kind of movie we're actually in, which then organizes the second viewing. I'll just stop with that.
I'm sorry to keep harping on this, but it's really why.
No, you're not.
Being selfish, it's why I came to the seminar, and I don't know if everybody shares the same interest.
Well, I think everyone should speak from their interest. That's what
But again, I see the same tensions in your paper as Robert's, in that though here you're trying to account for the horizon of expectations that viewers bring to these films based on their previous experiences, and trying to use that to make what I perceive to be a sort of higher argument that, you know, Hitchcock is fully aware of these expectations, and just because he's making a commercial film doesn't mean that there isn't extreme opportunities for innovative artistic expression, right? And that's just what you mean by if we change any moments in this shower scene, it's not as effective like a Shakespearean song. But Hitchcock, more than anything else, was an unabashedly commercial filmmaker, right?
Sure. Well, why do you think there's a contradiction there? I mean, this is like saying, if you want to make a statue of a goddess, it shouldn't be made out of clay or metal. It should be made out of pure spirit. I mean, no, that is the material. And it's crucial to my account of what a Hitchcock film is, that we see it as just what you said initially, for it to be able to do what it does. So it's, not only isn't that a tension, it's a condition of my account of a Hitchcock film that it fit your description. The question is whether that description provides the frame that it's exhaustive for sufficient understanding of it. The tension seems to me here. This frame is exhaustive, and you're claiming it's not exhaustive. That would be a tension. So it's a tension between, I think, a demand you're bringing and one that I'm not bringing. But there's no tension at all in my account. Rather, there's a requirement in my account that it have the characteristics you're talking about. It must have them.
Well,
it can't knock through that false bottom unless it first invites us to think it has that false bottom.
Well, what I mean is, you know, here you're talking about the censorship code, the Hays Code, and I'm glad you mentioned it, right, that this is, in a lot of ways, restricting his decisions about nudity, about violence, right, that these are industrial conditions that are limiting what he can do, and therefore he has to be creative within that, with that context.
I think that limitation is part of the discipline that allows for great art. I compared that to the sonnet form. So the sonnet form of Shakespeare is really limiting what he can do. God damn it. I mean, you know, the last word in line two has to rhyme with last word. And he has this great idea for the ending, but he can't find it. I mean, this thing is really limiting it. But that's a misunderstanding of the relationship between matter and form and art. I mean, that constraint is part of what he works with. But then he doesn't just, as it were, solve the problem of getting on the words line. He winds up putting words there which our account of why they're there goes vastly beyond why they're not. And that's what I said about the censorship code at that period. Yes, it's absolutely true he has to meet this constraint. And one of the things that the montage does is it never gives you a clear and nice visual, as it were, fix on a naked human body where you can see breasts or anything else. But if that's your whole account of why the scene is shot that way, then you're missing all the things I described. That is part of the constraint. I do think, in fact, I was making a stronger claim, which is that we have all these constraints that he works within as part of what allows it to, as it were, create the, as it were, initial appearance of a false bottom. So his constraints are incredibly enabling. He can only, as I put it, exploit those expectations to his own ends if he can engage them. And he can only engage them by, as it were, inheriting those constraints. I think this is also, as it were, generally true of genre films, what I said at that level of abstraction, interesting westerns, romantic comedies,
right,
wars, and so on.
With one more and then I'll shut up.
Right.
Because it seems to me the elephant in the room here for the horizon of expectations Alfred Hitchcock presents, right? It's his television show in which he barely directed any of them, 19 out of the 372, but it is attributed as being the auteur of them because of his persona that he's constructed for himself. So, because of how nobody wanted to make Psycho because of the source material not being appropriate for the production code. He made it cheaply in black and white versus color like Vertigo. He financed it largely by himself, right? That these decisions are driven more by industrial motives than they are artistic aspirations.
Right, I mean, and this is true of Shakespeare too. He wrote a lot of poems, and some of them he whipped off quickly for certain occasions. And you could say, no, all he's really trying to do is rhyme up words. And you can see that best from like the birthday rhymes he wrote for his children. I mean, that's, you know, if so there is a question here. This is the thing I actually start this essay with, which is what is the role of discrimination in choosing examples? When we try to understand what the logic of a genre is. Do we just choose all the things that are produced by a certain industry? If we do that, then, or if we just say, Alfred Hitchcock films or anything Alfred Hitchcock's names are produced to, then the kind of theory that's going to be adequate to it, I agree with this actually, is going to have already been determined by the character of that selection. Conversely, if we're developing a certain kind of conception of a kind of movie that Hitchcock made that has a kind of interest for the subsequent history of cinema, for instance, and how it was shaped by his work, then we're not going to be able to choose any example. And then I gave a lot of features. Some of the features have to do with the way in which it starts up aligned to a genre and explodes it. Part of it has to do with layers of meaning in the dialogue. Part of it has to do with the way in which all kinds of different extraordinary features of montage and camera angle have the significance that we can only recover. Some of it has to do with, for instance, I don't think it's true of any of those TV scenes, including the ones he made, because they were made for TV. And TV wasn't something you could review back then. That you need to see them twice to see them at all.
Well, so almost every television episode has a twist ending. And
it has a twist ending, but it doesn't have a twist ending, which if you watch the TV show again, you see all these things you didn't see.
Sure it does.
I don't think to that same degree, no. I mean, we could discuss it. But anyway, I'm not, but I also think this is true of his movies, especially if we go through his early movies, you know, his English period, the early Hollywood period. The kinds of things I'm describing, I think, come to be more and more true of his art through a certain kind of period. We could talk about which movies, I think Shadow of the Doubt was the one where he first really started like developing this craft with respect to these features in the same kind of depth. We can talk about which of the works, you know, best exemplify this description of this kind of film. But the point is the selection is going to have to go through the details of what one's claiming for the example, and then look at the other examples through those details. If it's just something like produced by Hollywood, you know, TV Guide lists it as belonging to the genre, or we know Alfred Hitchcock's name was put on it and got money from it. If that's what produces the selection of the examples, then already I think the kind of reflection I'm interested in is excluded, because one's got the wrong kind of data. It'd be like collecting a mouse, an elephant, and an insect and trying to figure out what the characteristic features of this species are. We don't have a species. We first need to have a concept of a species to know, you know, what the relevant, as it were, characteristics that they have in common is. So I completely agree that if the selection of examples is indiscriminate in that way, then everything I'm saying is of no interest in. One can generate counterexamples. The question is, if one generates a certain kind of description of what the most interesting Hitchcock movies do, and I think a relevant feature here is also how they shape subsequent cinema. Then, given that description, as Robert put it, that's going to have to be a fairly thick description. I've only quickly said some things about it. Then one has to look and see what falls under it. And there isn't actually anything that excludes a movie not being made by Hitchcock, being more of a Hitchcock movie, or belonging to this genre in the sense I described it, than many things that he made. What makes it fall into this category is not some external biographical datum, but the structure of organization of the work itself. That's going to be the thing that puts me in the category.
All right, well, way over time, sorry.
I think we have time for one more.
So one question, this talk about multiple views keeps coming up. I think it's really fruitful to think about it.
Yes.
And it seemed like, I don't know if I'm allowed to say things like the proper way to appreciate a film, but it sure seems like the claim is that to properly appreciate it requires multiple viewings. You might think that this flows from a kind of aesthetic necessity, that is how it is to be appreciated. But another view might be that it flows from a kind of cognitive necessity, insofar as we're not ideal epistemic agents, my memory is faulty. I'm wondering, sort of points you're getting at, like, look, in the first viewing, I seem to see this a different way, right? Then on the second viewing, I seem to see it rather differently.
Does the sense in which, to really understand what's interesting deep about a movie, what it's actually about, requires multiple viewings, is not a generalization about anything that you call a movie. That is, as it were, an ideal. It's fulfilled in different degrees by different films. And so I'm saying that is an ideal with which Hitchcock works. I mean, it's a trivial fact about any movie you might forget. But I don't think it's true about most movies that you find out it's not at all about what I thought it was about. And the real interest of all of those lines of dialogue was something I completely missed. And what's actually happening in this scene is obviously Norman dressed up as mother, which I completely missed. This isn't failure of memory or mere cognitive imperfection. It's that you could have attended as hard as you wanted the first time, and you couldn't have seen what now obviously seems significant, which starts a completely different kind of activity of interpretation, different in kind. For instance, you're not just thinking about the plot, but you're thinking about how this is about fantasy and relationship. You know, that starts seeming to be what the movie is about. You're much less interested in what happens to the money the second time. You're not looking around to see, where is it now? You know it's going into the swamp, and it's not the engine. So this is something, the thing I was trying to describe is not a truism about any movie. It's a feature of a kind of structure that it takes incredible work to put in it, so that the extent to which this is true of a Hollywood movie, while it's seeming like a Hollywood movie, and what I mean by it seeming like a Hollywood movie is it does seem to be something whose intelligibility is available on one viewing, the way in which a work of whom everything I said is not true also, as it were, meets that description. That it can do both of those things at once is something that I think requires, as it were, a particular kind of ambition. This is not what all Hollywood filmmakers are trying to do, or trying to do all the time. So I think the thing I meant by saying this, and maybe I haven't found the right words for describing it, is missed if it's reduced to the truism of just being able to haul all the details into the
view. No, I certainly, like, I don't take it to be a truism in that sense. I guess I'm just wondering about, is the talk about indexed viewings illuminable in terms of upon sustained reflection? And of course it's not true of...
Could you say it again?
So you help yourself in the sort of critical analysis to talk about this idea of indexed viewings, yes. Right? And in some sense, the aesthetic appreciation of the object requires these indexed viewings.
Yeah, my descriptions of the scenes are indexed.
Right. Right. And so I wonder about this case where, look, if I was a perfect cognitive agent, then one... And I take that you just think this is mistaken.
Yes.
That it would be possible for me to just say, instead of upon second viewing, no, upon sustained
viewing. Yeah,
saying
that makes no sense with these objects.
Right, and then I guess I start wondering, like, why aren't there two works here? The first work and the second work, and it just ends up being the
That's
same.
That's a great question. I love that question. The first, notice how the first thing really doesn't work. I mean, if you notice the Kansas accent, you know, you're just going to think this is bad acting. You don't have anything to do with it. You know, it's not something you can notice and interpret. You know, whereas it seems like the heart of the scene on a second viewing, if you notice it, that she can't stay in Madeline's character. But that requires that you understand she's not Madeline. Just like on a second viewing of Psycho, you have to understand that the mother, I mean, it's a little hard even how to put this because it's so complicated in Psycho, but the mother isn't the mother, or Norman isn't Norman. You know, those are really primitive descriptions of who they are. But those aren't thoughts that could just occur to you and even mean anything on the first viewing. I mean, what they mean is something you gradually work out in the light of the end and several viewings. So first of all, if you were a perfect viewer in the sense that you just, like, noticed, gee, this is really badly shot. The mother is like 8 inches taller than Mary and really straight and thin. You're not going to know what to do with that. And similarly with the accent. So what you're noticing, you know, everything, it's not as if movies are just documentaries that give you a window into the world. You attach significance. You attach significance to a cut. You attach significance to a bit of soundtrack. It's not a mere noise. It's something that carries meaning through how it's organized. And only till you have a different principle of organization does it acquire that significance. So it's very important that what you said is right. I just want to emphasize that. That the fantasy of perfect, as it were, cognitive apprehension would give us nothing we need that we're acquiring later. It, what it might notice is all sorts of things that might just be like evidence that's really badly made. And then when we see it again, we go, oh, it's better made than I thought. But probably if you were noticing all of that the first time, you wouldn't have been noticing things you needed to notice it's better made. So then why isn't it just two movies? And the reason it's not two movies is because one of the things the movie is about is the assumptions we make. That is, the kind of way in which we identify and we discover that identification to itself, been self-deceptive or blind, is itself a topic in the movie. We need to identify with Scotty's fantasies and feel their force, to then feel the force of how horrifying his fantasies are and what they've led to. But we experience that in a completely different way if we find ourselves subject to those fantasies. Similarly with Psycho, I think, it's very important that, you know, if Norman just comes into view for us on the second view in a different movie as a mere monster who we cannot identify with, this is a completely different experience. It's very important to us on the first viewing. He seems to be this somewhat sympathetic person who, when he speaks of the idea of private traps and so forth, actually helps Marion realize that she has stepped into her own private trap. And then Marion comes out of that conversation thinking, back to Phoenix. And then she says her real name, Marion, is it Crane, not Samuels. She's starting to tell him the truth. And we seem to be within a genre we understand, of which Hitchcock made many stranger versions, namely what we might call scenes of emotional rescue, in which, in the typical Hollywood version, the male rescues the lost female. And and it's only through those identifications that we are locked into Norman in a different way in a second view. So I think it's very important that the second layer of significance it has depends on the first, both because of the ways in which we need to overcome the first to understand the second. It's not just that we need to put it aside like a veil we strip out, but it's through it that we understand the second, and because of the forms of responses that were elicited from us in the first, we can't just condescend to the film and the characters, because we found our own horizons to be limited in the way theirs were. That's one thing I don't like about certain readings of Hitchcock films, is they remain very comfortable condescending to the movies in just the ways that he wants to expose, as it were, the cognitive, if you will, deficit in that form of condescension. So it's not two movies. The second one depends on the first one. That's the answer.
I think we're going to have to break for lunch, but thank you very much for that.